wonder if we could all stand this morning. So glad to be in church with you. Let's open this service up with prayer. Let's invite God's presence here. Let's lift our voices with our faith this morning. Lord, we thank you, God, for your word. We thank you for your presence, God, in our lives, Lord, that drawing power. Lord, we ask you to visit us today, God, and touch us and move among us, Lord. Perform what only you can do, Lord, in Jesus' name. Everyone say, in Jesus' name. Let's clap our hands.
You are the undefeated one, my life and my salvation. When the wicked, my enemies, and my foes, they come call me to ruin my faith, they stumbled and fell. Omnipotent, almighty, defender, my victory, my refuge, the one I run to. You are the God, you are the God of the breakthrough. Breakthrough, you are the God of the breakthrough. From when I can't see my way through, and I really don't know what to do, I look to you. Breakthrough, walls fall down when I shout through. Strongholds break when I play through. So I'm gonna praise you. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough.
There you are.
You are the undefeated one, my life and my salvation. With the wicked, my enemies and my foes, they call me to ruin.
Someone call him omnipotent.
Omnipotent.
He's almighty.
Almighty defender. My victory. My refuge. The one I run to. You are the God. You are the God of the breakthrough.
Oh, set breakthrough.
Breakthrough.
You are the God.
You are.
Someone look at your neighbor and say, he's the God of my breakthrough. Now lift your hands to heaven and say, God, you're the God of my breakthrough. Hey, if you believe it, clap your hands in this building today. Come on, let's worship the Lord.
Beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning.
Say joy!
Joy unspeakable and full of joy.
that we just sang were true. Amen. Come on, we sow it in tears. It's hard sometimes. Come on, somebody. I feel it in this building today. When Scripture says, be not weary in what? Come on, say it. Be not weary in well-doing. You just keep doing what you're doing. You keep sowing it in tears and you'll reap it in joy. For the joy of the Lord is my strength. Come on, all over this building, would you lift your hands in His presence? Come on, I feel the Lord in here. Let Him turn some tears into joy today. Come on, let Him turn some mourning to dancing in this building. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
I throw off despair and put a garment of praise on. I let go of shame and receive.
Somebody declare that in this room.
Because you hold my future, your kingdom here and now.
Lift your voice and say,
everything is changing now. Everything is changing now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Miracles are breaking.
Your kingdom here at
last. Lift your hands and say this with us.
Everything is changing now. Everything is changing now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Miracles are breaking out. Your presence is among us.
Yeah.
everything is changing now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Miracles are breaking out. Your presence is among us now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Clap our hands all across this building. How many is thankful for the presence of God in your life? Hallelujah. Everything changes. It doesn't matter how you came, what situation you have going on. Come on, God can change it. God can fix it. Amen. Hallelujah. God, with God, all things are possible. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So thankful to be back. There's nothing like being home, is there? So many beautiful faces. We just got back from vacation. I know nobody noticed. Amen. No, but my son running around. But thankful to be home. Love you all. Love this church. How many loves this church?
Amen.
How many loves being in a worshiping church? Well, I do have an announcement. How many wants more of God? The Bible says if you'll draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. How close do you want to be? Amen. We've got our intersection rally this Friday at North Pleasant's Church, North Pleasant's Tabernacle up in St. Mary's. And that will be this Friday, August 18th at 7 p.m. We're looking for a great move of God up there. Amen. I remember when I first come to church, when I first started coming, 2017, I wanted to attend everything I could. Amen. I still do. So fun worshiping God together. Hallelujah. Brother Mark's going to come. How many is ready to give today? Hallelujah.
There's multiple ways you can give. You can mail your tithing and offering to 1122 Market Street, Parkersburg, West Virginia, 26101. Or you can give at thecrosschurch.net. Or you can text the word to give to 1-877-681-7188. If we could all stand as the ushers prepare to receive the offering and tithing. And church, let's pray. Upon the authority of your word, I have given, and it shall be given to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither. I bring my tithes today to your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked, and the curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there's not room enough to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished, royalties received. We receive our family saved and walking with God, perfect health and abundance, walking in divine favor and blessing. I am blessed going in. I am blessed going out. All I do will prosper. In Jesus' name, amen. Sunday school is dismissed, and you can be seated.
this morning. I'm just glad to be in the house of God today. In such a beautiful crowd, and just feasting off of the week and what God's done. If you can, I want you to, everybody that can, and we had such a great crowd on Thursday night, but if you weren't here, please make it a part of your daily or your weekly schedule and write it in. Get your phones out and put Thursday night, 7 p.m., Cross Church worship. Praise God. Can I get a witness in here? Praise the Lord. If you didn't hear it, I want you here on Thursday nights as well. Praise God. And I'm going to tell you, God moves in such a special way on midweek. I tell you what, we can't run our spiritual lives like we do. If we run our vehicles like we run our spiritual lives, sometimes we'd run out of gas. I want to be full in the Holy Ghost, don't you? Praise God. I do want to say before we go to the Word, give honor to our music ministry and all the tireless effort. Sometimes I know they're here 3 hours on Saturdays practicing and making right. The Bible says the Levitical priesthood waited upon their business. And I'm so thankful we got music ministry here that waits upon their business, and they take it serious. How many's thankful for the ministry and the music that happens here on Sunday mornings and midweeks? Thank you, Sister Mindy, for your hard work. Praise the Lord. If you could stand this morning and turn to the book of Micah, chapter 7. And I give honor to my mom and dad. Love them so much. Sat beside of me in church. Man, I remember you wearing me out in church. I see all these parents chasing kids. Oh, this is great. And I remember mom would take me out and wear me out. I think sometimes she, how many times you take me out? She said as much as 10. I looked at these kids this morning, I thought, oh, they're going to get it today. They're going to get it today. I remember my dad, how many's noticed the kids in here today? Isn't it wonderful? Everybody say sometimes. Look, seeing Sister Jill up here trying to worship and the kids swinging jackets. And that's what she gets, ain't it, Brother Jeff? Ain't that what she gets? And you got to love the church. I'm glad they're here worshiping God. I looked and little Lincoln came up and put his little foot up on the altar and she went, what? He's sitting there like this, one little foot. And he came up and he was like this, just. And I got so tickled. He was like, yeah, you just having church? She said, where'd he get that? I went. I do it all the time right there. I put my foot up there. But you know what? These kids love them so much. And I remember we was somewhere and we was sitting on the front row, Daddy. I think it was in Piqua, Ohio, if I remember correctly. And somebody came over and said, why do your kids sit like that? He said, well, we had to teach them. Praise God. Well, God's good. Love our church family. It feels good in here today. How many's ready for the Word? Praise the Lord. Micah chapter 7 and verse 6. I'm going to read through verse 8. This first scripture will depress you, but I'm thankful for verse 7. Praise God. Are you ready? For the son dishonoreth the father, the daughter riseth up against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are the men of his own house. Everybody go, woo. I love this next verse. Therefore, hey, when it gets real bad, right? The son dishonoreth the father, the daughter riseth up against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are men of his own house. Everybody say, really? Therefore, I will look unto the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. Come on, read it with me. My God will hear me. Rejoice not against me, O mine enemy. When I fall, I shall arise. And when I sit in darkness, the Lord shall be a light unto me. When it gets real bad, when it gets real bad, I'm going to look to the Lord. And it doesn't matter what the enemy says. I'm going to preach for the next little bit. I might go 20 minutes. I might go 40. I don't know. We might party around here a little bit. But I come to encourage you. Nothing more than encourage this church, those that are home online today, those that are here. I come to encourage you. We need encouragement. How many's been dealing with a little stuff this week? Now, when I start preaching a little bit, you got to help me because we're going to encourage one another in the Holy Ghost today. I want to preach on this subject for the next little bit. I am not that tired yet. Come on, want you to say it with me. I want you to declare it. I am not that tired yet. One more time. I am not that. Say it again. I want you to get it in your spirit. I am not that tired yet. Look at somebody beside of you. Point up and say, I'm just not that tired yet. Can we lift our hands all over this building and love the Lord? God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what you're about to do in this house today. I pray, God, that you would anoint me to preach in this house. God, anoint your ears to hear. Help us, I pray, in your precious name. Lord, I need your anointing today and your favor in Jesus' name. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost. Why don't we just pray here one more moment? Somebody praise him in this house. Come on, you weary? Somebody praise him. You're not that tired yet. Go ahead and praise him. We're not even preaching yet, but I feel a praise coming on. We're not even in the word yet, but I feel a praise coming on. Hallelujah. Oh, somebody praise him in this house. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm not that tired yet. Woo, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. If you go help me preach, you may be seated in Jesus' name. Praise God. This year, my family and I, we took a little longer vacation than usual. We took 10 days. And I believe when somebody says, I'm going on vacation, it used to be that when I was a young pastor, Papa, I would always go, oh, another family. Not now. You tell me you're going on vacations. I said, go enjoy yourself because I'm going to take one too. I might take two. If you take two, I'm going to take two. You take three, I might take three. I love vacation. Justin, you was gone about a month. I love vacation time because, man, I'll put a ball cap on and I just turn into Dave. I do. I spend time with my family and I believe in it. And we were staying in this unique home, an Airbnb. We did that before we went to our vacation home, just a couple days. And it was kind of inland and on the sound. And it was just kind of a rustic house. It was really unique to stay there. I love seeing those different types of homes. And I was walking through the next day, was there for like 2 days. And they had a bookshelf there, Daddy. And I looked, and I will tell you as a funny, they had this pool online, and it looked huge. I got there, and I'm telling you, it's about the size of a bathtub. I said, you're talking about good marketing. That's the smallest pool I've ever seen in my life. It was cold as an ice cube. It was just, it has nothing to do with what I'm preaching. It's just a memory. And I was walking through the house, and there was this bookshelf, and I looked on the bookshelf, and I don't read a whole lot of books, but I looked, and on this bookshelf was a title. And it said, 100-year-old man walks out of a window. I said, I got to read that book. I'm too ADHD to sit down and read a whole book. I'm the guy that goes to the end of under the book because I want to know what happened. Y'all with me? Anybody ADHD in here at all? High definition. Attention deficit disorder. Daddy, I got in that book, and I started reading. I want to read just a couple excerpts of it, and you'll understand. 100-year-old man walks out a window. You might think he could have made up his mind Monday, May 2nd, 2005. You'd have think he thought he would have made up his mind a little earlier and been man enough to inform his surroundings of his decision, but Alan Carlson had never been given to pondering things too long. So the idea had barely taken hold in the old man's head before he opened the window of his room on the ground floor of the old folks' home and stepped out into the flower bed. The maneuver required a bit of effort since Alan was 100 years old. On this very day, in fact, there was less than an hour to go before his birthday party would begin in the lounge of the old folks' home. The mayor would be there, the local paper, and all the other old people and the entire staff led by bad-tempered Director Alice. It was only the birthday boy himself who didn't intend to turn up. Alan Carlson hesitated as he stood there in the flower bed that ran along one side of the old folks' home. He was wearing a brown jacket with brown trousers, and on his feet, he had a pair of brown indoor slippers. He was not a fashion plate. People rarely are at that age. He was on the run from his own birthday party. Another unusual thing for a 100-year-old, not least because even being 100 is pretty rare. Alan thought about whether he should make the effort to crawl back in through the window to get his hat and shoes, but when he realized how hard it would be, he decided not to go. The director, Alice, who he said was mean, says she always had a sixth sense because she always found his vodka. She thought that was funny in the book. He's 100 years old drinking. I said, what in the world? So she's always nosing around, finding everything he was getting into. But when he thought, he reached back and he grabbed his, he realized he had his wallet. He decided, I'll just go on without my shoes. He turned to take one last look at the old folks' home that until a few months ago he had thought would it be the last residence on earth. I want you to hear me. This is a man that doesn't claim to be righteous. At 100 years old, steps out of a window. And he does something here. He says a statement that I want to hand you today as a gift. He told himself that he could die some other time in another place. Everybody else had wrote him off at 100. But something got on the inside of this 100-year-old man. He said, I think I'll climb out a window on my birthday. When everybody else is planning to celebrate my age, I think I'll celebrate my age by walking out and seeing life again. Doing something different that I've never done before. There's more to the book. I still haven't finished it because it's so funny. He robs some guy and takes his suitcase and gets on a train. Somebody say 100 years old. I think something ought to get inside of our spirit today that if a 100-year-old sinner could get something inside of him and say, I'm just not that tired yet. I think I got one more adventure. I think I got something else I can do. I know you're weary. I know you get tired. But would the God Cross Church would get that same spirit inside of them? Say, I'm not that tired yet. I'm not going to quit. David prayed a prayer in Psalm 6 and 2. He said, have mercy upon me, O Lord, for I am weak. Lord, heal me. My bones are vexed. David said, I have mercy on me. There's things going on in my life, and I'm weak. It's okay to be weak. I want to stop here a moment. It's okay to get tired. It's okay to be weak, but it is not okay to quit. Let me try it over here. It's okay to get weary. It's okay to be tired. It's okay to lose your breath every once in a while. But it is not okay to say, I've had enough and I'm done. The church has got to rise up and say, I'm not that tired yet. Somebody say it with me. I'm not that tired yet. 2 Samuel pens these words, and it's King David. He said, I am this day weak. Read it with me. I am this day weak. Though anointed. Some of you just now getting it. I heard you. Woo! I heard you back there. I am weak. Today I'm weak. But don't you forget that my strength does not come from push-ups. I'm weak today, but I'm anointed, baby. Hell better hear me. I might get weak. I might get weary. But I'm not going to quit. I'm still anointed. The same anointing that got on David that killed a Goliath is the same anointing that can get on you to make you. Oh, would to God somebody help me preach today. I might be weak, but I'm anointed. I might be weak, but I'm anointed. Some of you hadn't even moved yet. I'm coming after you this morning. Some of you sit back and you're Pentecostal lazy boy. I'm going to climb chairs and get you. Are you really that weary? You can't clap your hands in church. Has God ever did something for you? You ought to clap your hands. You ought to do. I'm not that too tired. I haven't got so tired I can't praise God. In case you hadn't heard, I'm just not that tired yet. I like our Pillars ministry. I was out fishing while some of y'all was playing video games. Where y'all at? Y'all still here? I was out fishing yesterday. I love it. I was having a blast. Our Pillars ministry, our seniors group, was out fishing. They don't like being called seniors. I'm going to be careful. They might throw something. I don't want them climbing out windows here and going to another church. We're glad you're here. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost. Don't let hell tell you you've done too much. Oh, go ahead and just kick back. You don't have to do nothing else. Why? Why? Who said you can't do ministry? Who said you can't win a soul? Who said you can't pray? Who said you're not relevant? Hell? You? I come to tell you, don't be so tired you want to quit. There ought to be something to get inside of you that says, I might be weak, but I'm still anointed. I still got a calling on my life. Anybody believe this? The Bible says that in Mark chapter 10 that Jesus came through Jericho. Everybody say one more time. This was the last time he would come through Jericho. He would not come back through there again. He would die on a cross. He comes through this city, and there's a man there called Bartimaeus. He's got an adjective which everybody calls him. We know him as what? Blind Bartimaeus. Let me give you a little punchline here. He was healed, but they still called him blind. He's still known today. Preachers preach all over the world. Blind Bartimaeus. Blind Bartimaeus got healed. But he got stuck with his name. Have you ever been there? God delivered you, but they still call you by what you come from. I'm going to preach a little bit right here. He was by the highway side begging. And when he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was there, he began to cry out. Read that. He began to cry out and say, this is what some yelling, Jesus, have mercy on me. Come and help me. I'm like, why'd you say? These kids nowadays won't even talk. I'm like, what'd you say, Theron? Like, what? Hey, Theron, what are you doing? Like, what? I said hi to one of the guys. I said, what was that? I'm your pastor. Greet me. Hi, pastor. Some of you come to God with your little voice. If you really want a miracle, if you really want God to touch you, you'll lift your voice a little bit. Well, I'm just not emotional. What? Yeah, go to a ball game, you're emotional. Your little kid on T-ball knocks a ball out there 5 feet and you're on your feet. Jesus has saved us. He has shed his blood for us. We got reason to cry out today. And the Bible says that blind Bartimaeus began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David. What he's saying, I know who you are. Have mercy on me. And many around him said, shh, be quiet, be quiet, be quiet. Shh, be quiet. They charged him, be quiet. Don't embarrass us. They told him to hold his peace. But he did what we need to do. But he cried the more. Have you ever told your kid to shut up and they did it anyways? Sadie's asking so many questions. Daddy, daddy, daddy. Hey, daddy, hey, daddy, hey, daddy, hey, hey. That's what she says. What is it? What does she say? Hey, hey, daddy. Hey, 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 daddy. Hey, hey. I'm hey, hey, daddy. What is it? Daddy, dad. Daddy, dad. Hey, 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 daddy, dad. I'm like, not now. Jesus is coming through, and here's this man that will not shut up even though he's being told to. He will not quit. Let me help you with something. He's blind. Sitting by the highway side begging. He don't even have money. Yelling for something he can't see. He just hears he's there. But he's willing to shout out to get the attention of Jesus. Let me hand it. He cried more. He got, let me put it in David Bounds' terms. He got louder. When's the last time you cried out to God for your situation? God, deliver me! God, have mercy on me. There ought to be something get inside of us. Do you need a miracle today? What would you do to get a miracle? How loud would you cry? And the Bible says, I feel like preaching in his house. Thou son of David, have mercy upon me. Look at verse 49. Somebody read this with me. Oh, we're going to preach right now. Come on, read them. And he did what? Daddy, he stopped. Who was that? But Jesus has a sense of humor. You see, when you yell out and you try to get God's attention, he stops what he's doing to hear you. Somebody say, God hears me. It ain't in the yell. I get that, but it is in your passion. It is in your willingness to get his attention. Notice what happens next. And he said, tell him to come here. God's got a sense of humor. He's blind. If Randy was blind, Brother Randy was blind, right now, and I said, he said, Pastor, I said, hey, tell him to come here. Randall. You imagine him trying to get to me right now, and he's been around this church 1,000 times. Come on, Randall. How many thinks it'd take a little bit? I'm being funny. I don't mean to be disrespectful. Brother Randy, I love you so much. At the end of the day, Jesus called for him to come to him, and he had to work through his disabilities to get to Jesus. Oh, well, you know, I'm spiritually handicapped. Oh, no, you're not. You see, if you get enough passion, blindness won't keep you from Jesus. Sickness won't keep you from. You'll crawl across the ground to get your miracle. I'm just not that tired yet. I need God to touch my life. I need God to touch my life. The Bible says he did something. Get up here, Brother Justin. Get up here. You're going to preach with me a little bit. And the Bible says before he got to Jesus, that he had to do something. He had to take his jacket off. I'm glad you have long sleeves on today. That would have been bad. And he did something. He cast away his garment. He took off what identified him as a blind man, a beggar, and threw it down. It's sad when you still look like what you come from. Y'all ain't gonna preach with me. I said it's sad when you still look like what you come from. You're trying to still be identified with the world and its culture. Some of y'all ain't moving, but I'm preaching real good. Some of y'all need to walk out. You walked out of addiction, but you still got all the paraphernalia. I know people walked out of witchcraft, but they still look like what they... I wouldn't have gotten to church. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. Thank you. He got rid of what identified him and came to Jesus. What do you want me to do? He said, I could be healed of my sight. He said, go thy way, thy faith. Your faith is powerful. But if you decide to use your spiritual handicaps to hold you back, you'll never get your miracle. You got to make up in your mind. My daddy can't do this for me. My brother, my wife cannot do this for me. You got to get it yourself. I got to make up in my mind. The other day, I'm telling you, I was thinking, we got people from all walks of life. I'm like, God, there's so much in this word you want us to do. And I feel sometimes frustrated because there's so much that people need to do. But I'm just going to keep preaching the gospel because I trust in people enough that if they'll keep pressing, they're going to be reading their Bible and God's going to give them revelation about who you are and what you want. There does come times in life that you get tired and weary, but you got to use your faith and press through. Cross Church, we must in this last day, and I know this age, there's things going on, and I just don't fit in this world anymore. I don't feel at home. If you feel at home here, then you probably need to rethink your salvation. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. I don't fit in here anymore. There's another world that I'm a part of. Anybody feel like that today? I'm moving forward. But it drains you spiritually. How many knows what I'm talking about? And during the week, you go through so much. There's just this pull. It's like pulling a drain plug on a vehicle. Something happens during the week. That's why I tell you, get to church on Thursday. Oh, well, I don't need it. Uh-huh. Yeah, oh, I know. You're spiritually so strong, you don't need church on Thursday. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, you're powerful. The greatest Christians I know don't miss a service. Man, I'm challenging some of you right now. I know it's y'all squirming and everything. Y'all okay? I'm your pastor. I'm supposed to challenge you. It's time to get to church when the doors are open. I've been praying about doing a month of Sunday nights at some point. I heard three people. I like to do some Sunday nights. I like to do a month of it at some time. I don't know when yet. When God directs me, we'll do it. We did that for about a month or two a couple years ago. God moved in a powerful way. I believe more church is what we need, not less church. I don't know why I'm on this right now. We need to be faithful. We got discipleship. We got so much training going on. You say, well, I'm just not being fed at the church. That ain't my fault. You're starving yourself. I had somebody tell me that one time. I'm just not growing. I'm like, are you kidding me? Follow me around. It's time to fall in love with God. Y'all with me right now? Even when you get tired and the world's pulling you down, there's got to be something to get in you. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 1. He's talking to the angel, to the pastor of the church of Sardis. And he tells them, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and are dead. Verse 2, be watchful. Read this with me. And strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard and hold fast. And repent. He said, watch. Be careful. Strengthen the things that remain that are ready to die. I know you're tired, but you got to stop for a moment and see, how's my prayer life going? How's my attendance to church? How's my fasting? How's my daily devotion? How's my evangelism? How's my giving? The Bible says if we don't give, we're cursed. Will a man rob God? There's scripture. Man, it's quiet in here right now. Look at our lives together and see if there's anything about to die. And it's time to resuscitate the spiritual man and woman. God said it's time to be watchful and strengthen the things that remain. I tell you how to get life back in your attendance. Show up. Joy down in your life. With joy shall you draw waters of the well of salvation. Is praise dying in you? You can't let praise die. I tell you how to resurrect praise. It's to praise. Some of y'all ain't moving right now, but oh, clap your hands, all you people, and shout with a voice of triumph. There ought to be something to get. I'm not that too tired to praise God. I'm not too old to praise God. I'm not too young. Somebody help me today. I will clap my hands. I will lift my voice. Somebody in this house shout hallelujah. I'm going to strengthen the things that remain there. I will not let prayer die in my life. I will not let prayer die. I will not let attendance die. I will not. I know, and I'm not going to say who it is, but there's a preacher in this house, and he said, I give till it hurt. Now you start talking about money and people don't have it, get mad. Give till it hurt. Walked out of the church and got in the parking lot and got a phone call. And doubled their daily pay before they can leave the church property. Can y'all praise God for that? Is that not amazing? Because when you give, it shall be pressed down, shaken together, and running over. God wants to bless you. Strengthen the things. Look at somebody and say, strengthen the things that remain. 2 Chronicles 15 and 7. Be ye strong, therefore, and let not your hands be weak. Read it with me. Let's try it again. Be ye strong, therefore, and let not your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded. I want you to get that. I want you to move on real quick, because we're quick. You know, the roast beef's in the oven, you're on Texas Roadhouse, and Bob Evans is calling your name, and they got fried catfish now at Cracker Barrel. You can tell I'm 48. I know all the menus. I want you to stop on this Sunday morning for a moment. Be strong. Don't let your hands be weak. If you continue to work, it's going to be rewarded. Prison ministry is hard. I know we got a lot of guys from work release, and I'm so glad you're here. We got Celebrate Recovery starting in there this week. We'll starting on Thursday nights. A lot of stuff is going to be happening. But I remember there was one guy, and he was crazy. Oh, y'all think I'm kidding. Jughead was crazy. That's what they called him. Don't get mad at me. Like, I can't believe he called him that. Well, they called him that. Show up all the time, and Jughead was there, and he believed in aliens. I say he believed in aliens. Some of you are like, well, have you seen the news lately? Would you stop? That's where your brain went. Talk about something else. Go in there, that one guy's crazy. Sometimes ministry's hard, especially when you have a lot of loss in it. Been pastoring for years. I've preached to people, discipled people, have years into people, and they leave and don't even say bye. I mean, they don't even say bye. Like, see ya. I ain't going to see you at Christmas. I mean, it hurts. I mean, this is what I'm talking about. They just leave. Like, where'd they go? I don't know. Ministry can be hard, and you go through seasons. When you're a soul winner and you really win people to God and not just win them and see them born again of the water and spirit, talk in tongues and disciple them, it's hard. But I preach to you, soul winners in this house today, those that love God, that are in the fight, let me talk to you. Be strong. Don't let your hands get weak just because you've gotten weary. Because your work is going to be rewarded. The Bible says, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. I'm asking my leaders in this house, every department head, every preacher, every saint of God, every giver, every active, inactive member, it's time to put your shoulders back. I believe the angel could be putting a trumpet to his lips. Jesus is getting ready to come back and part the clouds. And it's time to work like you've never worked. Don't get so tired and weary that you stay home on Sunday. It's time to get to church. It's time to start winning people to God. Don't stop. Don't stop working in the kingdom. Don't stop working in the kingdom. There's got to be something. And I said it on Thursday night. I'm so thankful for all the ones that work in the kitchen downstairs. Last Sunday, I know they fed like 100 people. The Preston show up. So thank you, Brother Pitts and John and Johnny and John and John Jr. and Corey. And there's a whole crew. And then our bus ministry. We got Wayne Pitts cooking. And then you got Brother Chris. Where's he at? Is he hiding? You know, Chris, he's out there being security out front. He gets up about 6:30 in the morning, gets here, starts running buses. I want you to hear me. And he'll bring people all the way up to church time. And even last Sunday when I took the evangelist to entertain him, Columbo's, and we stayed a long time, it took a little bit. When I finally got back, I think between 1:30 and 2 o'clock, he was just now pulling in from his routes. Somebody say tired on a whole new level. He's been our transportation ministry director for probably, I know, of 10 years. Everything bringing people from work release to recovery homes, south side, all over God's. I'm going to tell you, we need people to start stepping up and say, I want to do something for Jesus Christ. Come on, we love what we get when we come here. How many ready to get involved in the ministry and start doing something for Jesus Christ? I want to tell you, if you encourage somebody, God will do a miracle. Somebody say encouragement. If you'll learn to encourage people, God will do the miracle. Somebody say, I'm just not that tired yet. Isaiah 35:1 says, the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. And the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. Somebody say, the desert? I'll see if she's listening. The wilderness and a solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and the dry place shall rejoice and blossom. It shall blossom, somebody say abundantly, and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given into it. The excellency of Carmel and Sharon shall, they shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Verse 3, let's read it. Strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with recompense. He will come and save you. Those of a fearful heart, those who are weak, those who need to be strong, God's going to show up. Those with weak hands, those with feeble knees, those with knees that hurt, that before it rains, you can tell it. Got this arthritis thing going on in my hand. I can tell you when a storm's coming. The hand won't work. Getting older. I can still get you with that one, but that one will hurt on a rainy day. Strengthen. He will. God with recompense will come and save you. It means make amends to someone for loss, harm, suffered. God said, I'll come and repay everything bad's happened to you. If you'll start encouraging people, I'll start showing up. That's what it says. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong. See, this is going to include you. I'm talking to you now. You want the preacher to do it. Look at somebody and say, be strong. Be strong. Be strong. Fear not. Your God's coming to help you. Turn somebody else beside of you. Be strong. Fear not. My God, church, help me out this morning. Come on. Somebody stand up and turn around and look at somebody and say, be strong. Y'all will have to help me preach. I'm not moving on until y'all help me out. We ain't moving any further. Be strong. Fear not. God's coming to help you. Try it one more time. Be strong. Fear not. Lord, have mercy. I'm not moving. Some of y'all don't believe it. I need my work release to help me or something. I need people from recovery homes to stand. I need some mom and dads and grandpas to stand up right now. Put your shoulder. Come on, let's help. Come on, stand up. I'm not moving until we get in this. Y'all standing up too. All you teenagers, get up. I know y'all wore out from all your games this week. Y'all stand up. Got you, didn't I? Y'all ready? Put your shoulders back. Now turn around to somebody. Make it real awkward. I mean awkward. You don't know them probably. Say, be strong. Fear not. My God's coming to help you. Tell somebody else. Fear not. Be strong. My God's coming to help you. Don't get so tired and weary that you quit. God's coming to build you up. Oh, I'm going to try to shut this down. You stay standing. Isaiah 35:5. After you encourage, look what's going to happen. Read it with me. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. Help me out. And the parched ground, pool, and a thirsty land, springs of water. In the habitation of dragons, where each lay shall be grass and reeds and rushes, and a highway. Come on, help me out. And a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, or any ravenous beast shall go therein. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed. I know y'all having trouble. Let's try it. But the redeemed shall walk therein, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy with their heads. I come to tell you, if we'll start encouraging one another, the blind is going to see, and the deaf are going to hear. People are going to get out of wheelchairs. We're going to see the miraculous. Somebody praise him in this house right now. I am not that tired yet. Tell him, Leon. You hear that? Say it again, Brother Leon. I'm not in it, Pastor. Any young person, shout at me right now. I'm not that tired yet. Could Cross Church yell at their pastor and say, I'm not that tired yet. There cannot be any quitting you today. My God, I feel the Holy Ghost. There's not even any music playing right now, but I feel a surge of the anointing in this place. Jesus told Simon, he says, Satan has desire to sift you as wheat, to destroy you, to obliterate you in the wind. Jesus said, but I've prayed for thee that your faith fail not. And when you're converted, strengthen your brethren. There ought to be something to get inside of us that even on our lowest moments, I can't tell you how many times people about give up and they show up on a midweek service. Can't tell you how many times people show up and I find out later that's going to blow their brains out when they got home. They said, I got to go. I just got to go. And maybe God will help me. And they got God on a midweek service. And then God delivered them from that spirit. Joel 3:9. Proclaim ye this among the Gentiles. Prepare war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. And let the weak say, Anybody ever seen a bully in school? I've seen them in the prison. Been a long time in school. I can't remember all them. I got so many scraps. I got so many fights over bullies. I wasn't very big. I was a little fella. Man, couldn't stand bullies. I would smack you right now. I just wouldn't a daddy. I got so many fights. And most of them was over my brother. I can't tell you how many fights. We was playing Sandlot. I don't know why I'm telling this today. So I need to get some fight in your spirit. I remember we was playing Sandlot football. We lived in North Carolina. We didn't have a friend anywhere. We were so lonely. And they made fun of me because I was a hillbilly, you know. I didn't say soda. I said pop. They didn't know what pop was. They made fun of everything, made fun of my West Virginia sweatshirt. If you're from North Carolina, I love you. I love North Carolina. It was a hard time in our life. I'll never forget, we was playing Sandlot football, and a guy kept smacking my brother and hurting him real bad. And I said, you do it again. Now, I'm not condoning fighting. But as my little brother, I was like 12, 13, I was 12 years old, I think. And he smacked my brother. I hurt him so bad. My brother was like out of it on the ground. And I'd already told him. Anybody know what happened next? I told him. I said, don't you touch him again. You do it. I said, don't do it again. Sit down, hut. Boom. I mean, he hurt him so bad. Next thing I know, I was coming too. I kept my promise. Brother Preston, I'm going to tell sin on me. I was 12, but he was out cold in a seizure in a holly bush. Out. Eyes rolled back in his head, twitching. Scared me half to death. I'd have killed him. He started coming back too, Mama. And I was just looking at him like, don't you ever do that again. Mom didn't even know that much happened. He had little holes in him from the holly bush. I was standing there like, I didn't know I could do all that. The point is, even as a young man, I didn't want my brother being picked on in a strange land. I don't condone fighting. Please, kids, don't leave here and say, Pastor said. I was a sinner, and I'm saved by grace. But there ought to be something to get inside of us as adults. I was a kid. That when we see somebody being beat down by life and being beat down by the enemy in situations, that you step up in front of them. Come up here, Theron. Get behind me. Get up here. You're walking better now since that wreck. I'm glad you're doing good. And somebody's got to be able to get in front of them and say, no, don't touch them again. You got to get up here, Justin. I want you to get right here. He's the situation. Here's a soul. And saints, we get so wrapped up in self, we forget about the saint. You're so worried about you, you forget about everybody else. Me, me, me. We need to start focusing on others, and you'll forget about your problems in self. I'm preaching right now. When there's a situation, step in and say, not on my watch. Be strong. Be courageous. God's going to deliver you. And let's step in the gap for our brothers and sisters. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Let the weak say, I'm strong. Today in this house, if you can lift your hands and you've been going through a problem, I want you to shout with everything in you, I might have been weak, but I'm strong today. I am strong. I am strong. Whew. I am strong. Say it with me. I am strong. Romans 4:20 says, Abraham staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. He was convinced that God wouldn't fail him. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Anybody feel what I feel right now? How many feels encouraged today? Man, I feel encouraged. Joan, I remember when God told us to get this building. It's the most stressful time of our life. Your hair got gray. My arm hair's turning gray. What hair I got's gray. It's stressful. We didn't tell nobody, did we? Start to talk a little bit now. I remember thinking, how in the world are we going to pay the bills? I remember driving down the road and I would scream out. I dealt with a situation I might tell the church at some point. Had to sit on literally. I was subpoenaed by Attorney General Barr. You don't even know. Protecting this church. Should I tell him? I'm planning on doing this. I've kept this. I had a guy show up. Brother Carey, where you at? Run up here. Man, I just feel to tell it. Some of you need to know. Churches just aren't made. Had a guy show up one time. Carey's my safety director. Had a guy, and I seen him staging us in here. He's staging us on a Thursday night. I'm numb right now, even telling you. I saw him when he started coming out. The Holy Ghost quickened me, and I said, are you armed? And he gave me that look, and his hand went down, and I grabbed him like this, and I grabbed his arm, and I pulled a pistol, and I disarmed him. Brother Preston, I've never told this church. Brother Bruce, first time telling it. Disarm that man. Called the police. We interviewed him. And he was looking for soft targets. We were on the list. He is running guns. He's going to shoot this church up. Had to go and was subpoenaed. I'm glad we stopped him because he had other places he wanted to shoot up. He had an AR saw belt fed. Let me tell you, this world's so evil. See, some of you are scared. We had a team that saw it. It disarmed that rascal. Old country boy grabbed a hold of him. I was somewhere else the other day and somebody said, yeah, we got all kinds of security at our church. Said we heard there was a pastor in town a couple years ago, disarmed a crazy guy who was going to shoot up a church. And I said, that was me. me. I told him, Daddy, you remember I called you? I told him the FBI came here. I thought, man, this is going to be crazy. I'm sitting in a room. This will be out there now. I mean, this has been 6-7 years ago. I was sitting in a room with cameras all over me. It was FBI interviewing me. You talk about nervous, man. I said, this is like a bad movie. I start telling him what he said and what he did. He went to prison. I was subpoenaed by Attorney General Barr. Had to go testify about what I knew. You talk about tired. Tired on a whole new level. Bible college can't help you with disarming people. I told him, I said, I will testify. I mean, they can make me testify anyways. I said, please keep it out of the news. I don't want nobody to know about this. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want fear. I don't want nobody scared. I love my people, and I don't want to deal with fear. We got plenty of security. There was cops coming in and staying. Y'all didn't even know what was going on. We had cops outside, our police in the area. That man went to prison. But I remember Daddy coming from that court hearing that day. I was so nervous. I've never told this publicly. I've barely spoken this privately. I remember walking out, and it was a real big guy walked out with me. I mean, he was enormous. You know, I'm 5'7" on a good day, you know. Big old guy walking out, and I was going out like this, and he was following me. I didn't know who he was. I said, can I help you with something? I was like this, can I help you with something? He said, oh, Pastor. He said, I'm an agent. He said, thank you for today. He was so kind. I was just so nervous. I was so upset. The point is, I didn't sign up for that. I've had to deal with stuff that would blow your mind. I didn't sign up for that. Bible college don't prepare you for that. But Daddy, it don't matter what we go through. I've seen family troubles. Some of you are in absolute shock right now. But I made up my mind, I'm still going to preach the gospel. With good security, I'm going to preach the gospel. Sometimes they look like FBI, got them little things in their ears and all that stuff walking around here. I'm thankful for our security. But I'm not that tired. I remember coming up the road screaming. Like I couldn't even stop it from the anxiety, the panic. Driving home screaming from that day. Ah, I just kept screaming. Ah. Not a call. Kept on driving, no call. I'm like, is anybody even praying? I made up my mind. It doesn't matter what comes my way, I'll die preaching. Got to get in your spirit. I'm not that tired. Be serving God till Jesus comes back. I wonder if friends and family today, just as a declaration, we say, I'm going to serve God the rest of my life. And walk to this altar as close as you can and bring somebody with say, I'm going to serve God the rest of my life. I will not turn back. I will not. I commit to God. Can we do that in this house today? I want you to stand and declare it. I will not. I will not. Come on, everybody that will, can we make a declaration today? Nobody's going to make you pray, but just step out in a declaration saying, I'm going to leave my family. I'm going to leave my family in revival. I'm going to leave my family in a walk with God. Somebody pray in the Holy Ghost around this place right now. I'm not that tired. I'm not that tired. Thank you for coming. I'm not that tired. I'm not that tired yet. I'm not that tired. I told you I'm not shunned. make a declaration. Yes, I'm committed. I'm committed to the ministry. I'm committed to the kingdom. I'm committed to Jesus Christ. I'm committed to the gospel. I'm committed to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ministry, one of the greatest things that you can do is not praise or worship. I've learned one of the greatest things you can ever learn to do in the kingdom is this. Don't ever underestimate a man or a woman that's willing to just stand and not move. I know it might seem weird, but I just want you to just kind of, I want you to feel your feet. I want you to place them in one place and say, I'm here. I showed up. The greatest army is those that show up. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. You got to get the revelation of what standing is. I stand in my faith, and then I can lift my hands, and then I can clap my hands. Come on, could you lift your hands one more time and say, God, I'm committed to the kingdom. I'm standing. I will not back up. I'm standing. When I've done all I know to do, I stand. Stand there for me. Woo! Put on your war clothes. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Come on, let that declaration change to praise. And begin to praise Him in His house. Then get ready to sing. Somebody praise. Yes.
God is moving forward. The battle is here. It's all around. I
Dismissal, but I wonder if we can team up with someone. Come on, find somebody, put your arm around their shoulder, grab their hand. Come on, let's leave this place bound together in faith, bound together in the fight. Can somebody say amen? Hallelujah. If you're still praying, you continue to pray, but let's find somebody, let's link up with them, and let's declare when we leave this building today, hallelujah, I'm in the fight. I'm going to stand. Having done all, I'm going to stand. Come on, lift your voice and pray right now. You can feel the Holy Ghost right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare together, agreeing with one another, that in the name of Jesus, we will stand. When all hell comes against us, when the enemy comes in like a flood, Father, you will raise up a standard against him in the name of Jesus Christ. We're living today victorious. We're living today full of joy. We're living today full of strength. We're living today full of your spirit. God, send us forth. I'll go. Send me to the fight. Send me to the front line. Send me to the battle. Come on, would you clap your hands and rejoice in the Lord? Hallelujah. As you leave this building, look at two or three people and say, I've got the victory. Come on, go ahead and say it now. I got the victory. Amen. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord. Go forth mighty in him in Jesus' name.